A little more than 11 years ago, my home was broken into by a man wielding a knife. The very first and last room that he came across was that of my 12-year-old daughter asleep in her bed.
A mother's worst nightmare, her child assaulted, and in their own home where their family once felt safe. The perpetrator ran off free into the night, where the young innocent girl became trapped and frightened beyond recognition. It is this type of evil doing that provoked New York leaders to be at the forefront of crime-fighting legislation to swab DNA from every type of criminal who was convicted of a felony and penal law misdemeanor. The Senate sponsor believes it'll stop repeat offenders dead in their tracks.
We have to constantly be on guard here as a legislature to address whatever shortcomings may occur in our public safety system.
I can tell you from experience that in a perfect world, you would have plenty of eyewitnesses, you'd have video cameras, and you'd have forensic evidence, but it doesn't work out that way most of the time.
He proceeded to rape, cut, rob, and terrorize my child in her room, in our home, in her bed. His parting words to her were that if she told anyone, he would come back and kill not only her, but her entire family. This poor baby lay in her bed for we don't know how long until she felt safe enough to run upstairs to get me. Can you even begin to imagine the terror my child felt?
During brutal crimes, often there's an exchange of a biological substance. Investigators can collect this evidence at the crime scene, and forensic scientists can get a full genetic profile from just a few cells.
The DNA that we use on a daily basis is only as good as the database which we compare the DNA to.
For decades, the Senate majority has pushed to expand the criteria of collecting DNA from convicted criminals with the idea that the more DNA samples, the more likely to solve any crime where DNA evidence has been successfully acquired, as well as to prevent future offenses.
We started this process in the 90s. We have managed to go from sex offenses and homicides to the point where we now have misdemeanors. Misdemeanors are often gateway crimes, crimes that lead to other crimes.
Because of the chronic pattern of criminal behavior, the required DNA that's collected and entered into the system often links to other and sometimes unrelated cases being solved.
The predator that raped my daughter and shattered my family wasn't caught in the act of raping one of his subsequent victims, of which there were several. He was caught because he stole money from his employer, a petty larceny. For 10 years, he put my family through a living hell. He raped other women. And the thing that finally got him put behind bars was stealing a few dollars. And the only reason that happened was because of the new laws at the time.
Had the DNA been available, the perpetrator of these generally horrible crimes would have long been apprehended before they got to the number of crimes that he or perhaps she may have committed.
Collecting DNA evidence offers a balanced approach in crime investigations because it can eliminate wrongful convictions too.
You want to make sure that the people that didn't commit the crimes are released from their confinement in prison.
DNA alone has freed nearly 300 prisoners since 1989. According to the Innocence Project in New York, it was DNA evidence that helped exonerate 24 New Yorkers of crimes they didn't commit after serving a combined total of 277 years in prison.
I want to point to one criminal out in Western New York, the bike path rapist. In early 1991, Eltimio Sanchez was charged and convicted with patronizing a prostitute.
Had this DNA database been in place before, they would have had that information and they actually could have stopped him from committing additional crimes and additional murders.
DNA evidence collected through other means eventually led to his conviction as the bike path rapist in 2007, but not after numerous women were brutalized and killed. And a man was falsely convicted.
Held for almost 20 years for a crime that he did not commit. And the DNA would have actually set him free a lot earlier.
The man Senators Gallivan and Grisanti are talking about, Anthony Capozzi, is one of the 24 DNA exonerated cases in New York. Capozzi always maintained his innocence. His conviction was largely based on victims identifying him in a police lineup.
It's a counterweight to humanly flawed evidence that we've seen in evidence gathering techniques such as eyewitness identifications.
Each time we expanded the database, we made it a better resource for police, district attorneys to apprehend and prosecute criminals and to exonerate the innocent.
New York has already started the process of collecting DNA from all convicted criminals. Keyword, convicted. Stay tuned to nysenate.gov. We will continue to clarify how this monumental legislation will enhance public safety, providing more real-life examples of how relying on this scientific evidence finds truth, how the state database links with a national effort to solve crimes, guidelines for laboratories. In addition, we will take a look at how this first-of-its-kind all-crimes DNA law will help victims during the process of recovery from a traumatic criminal encounter.